Hello and welcome back to the official Scottish Rugby Podcast, together with the Royal Bank of Scotland. On the show this week, we sit down with Scotland coach Steve Tandy. Scottish Rugby President Dee Bradbury joins us in the studio as she embarks on her 50-kilometre trek through the Atlas Mountains. Plus, we reflect on a big weekend of rugby, including the Guinness Six Nations, the Scotland Under-20s and the Fosrock Super Six. Delighted now to be joined by Scottish Rugby President Dee Bradbury. Dee, thank you very much for coming along to the studio. Now, before we get on to your big adventure next month, I just want to talk a little bit about the game yesterday, because you played a very special part in that game yesterday, delivered the match ball. How was that experience for you?
It was very, very personal to me. It certainly reinforced what was a great day all round. My main fear was that the heels of my shoes would get stuck into the grass. And I'd already thought to myself, if that happens, I'll just keep walking and get my shoes on the way back.
I remember a few years ago, we had Doddy, who delivered the match ball in 2017, and here we are with you doing it in 2020. Kind of full circle, because you are doing some great work for Doddy next month. Just talk us through what it is you're planning on doing and the preparations going for that.
I'm actually quite terrified about the prospect of this walk. So it's a 50-kilometre trek through the High Atlas Mountains in Morocco. Wow. I think there's 26 brave souls attempting this. It's over 3 days, so 50 kilometres, I think it's 15 kilometres the first day, then 20, and then a further 15, and then finish off in a 5-star hotel where we finally get a shower after 3 or 4 days. So it's camping in the mountains. The weather could be very unpredictable. It could be strong sunshine during the day, but then absolutely snowing and freezing at night, so we have to prepare for every eventuality. Training. I haven't had much time to do much training. I think I'm going to have to rely on some sort of core skills. However,
natural fitness.
Yeah, and determination. Mm-hmm. When I told my husband that I'd signed up to do this, he just laughed. So that makes me all the more determined.
Support you want? Yeah,
exactly.
Have you done anything like this before?
No.
And what made you? Obviously, it was born from Duddy's Foundation, but it was an event you were at with the rugby people in the rugby community, and the penny dropped.
Well, there was a reunion lunch, and they had an auction section, and I couldn't afford any of the items that were up for auction. But then this project came forward, and I thought, at least if I can't afford anything financially, I can do this gesture towards the foundation, which is raising lots and lots of money for, as we know, a very, very sound cause.
What's your biggest fear?
The inclines, I think.
And is that early on in the walk? So that's
the
kind of fifth, would it be the first day then, the steep bit, or the steepest part?
But as I say, there's 26 of us, and from what I understand, it's varying backgrounds. And so I think it will probably be very, very good fun. And when you look at the photographs on the website, the scenery is outstanding, outstanding.
And you'll rely on those, only teammates, isn't it?
Yeah, absolutely.
And do you know anybody else who's gone?
The doctor who coordinates Doddy's care, Dr. Annabel Rill, she's sharing a tent with me. So we've spoken extensively on the phone, etc. And I think we'll get on very well. Maybe not so well at the end of the trip, because she's had to go out with me snoring all night and stuff like that. But I'm looking forward to meeting some different people.
You mentioned you're worried about the inclines and the trek itself, but you do come from quite an athletic background, don't you? So you mentioned in the kind of recent out that you were hoping that maybe some muscle memory would come back into play. But what was it you did athletics-wise back in the day, just for those who don't know?
Many years ago, I was a multi-eventer, so that's high jump, long jump, shot put, 800-metre hurdles, 800 metres and 100-metre hurdles over 2 days. So I achieved quite high honours at that. Played a lot of netball, went back to Masters Athletics when I was in my 40s, competed at the World Championships, but I haven't really done any exercise for a number of years.
You played rugby until fairly recently as well.
Oh yeah, I forgot about that.
wasn't that too long ago?
Yeah. I played rugby till I was 48.
But
that will help as well, the fact that you have that experience of being an athlete, that competitive edge. That how much will you pull on that, the competitiveness and the, you know, the desire to finish this and to push on? How much will that help you?
I'm quite a determined individual, quite a competitive individual, so I think if I can go home and say to my husband, I did the whole thing, that will give me an immense sense of satisfaction. So I just have to dig deep, and it's for a fantastic cause, so just try my very best.
And have you spoken to the person you're sleeping in the tent with? Does she know that you snore? Have you told her that yet, or that were you a surprise for her?
I think we'll keep that as a surprise.
I hope she doesn't listen to the podcast.
Mind that suggests you're getting some sleep if you're snoring, though. So there could be a positive in that. You never know.
And how long will it take you to get out there? How's your travel out to these to Talis?
So we fly from Edinburgh, or the group that's flying from Scotland fly from Edinburgh on the Thursday night, overnight in a hotel. Then it's a 5 a.m. meet at Gatwick Airport, and then the flight from Gatwick to Marrakesh. And then we fly back on the Monday, Marrakesh to Gatwick. And then it was supposed to be Gatwick to Edinburgh, but EasyJet have just cancelled the flight back. So we've had to make alternative arrangements for that. And I think, you know, there could be a lot of disruption travel-wise with the current climate and all the rest of it. So we'll just have to keep monitoring that and hope for the best.
You mentioned earlier on that you haven't been able to do as much training. This is obviously a very busy time for everybody involved with Scottish Rugby. Also being the president of Scottish Rugby as well, very busy time. Have you managed to put anything aside, any time aside to do any sort of training, or has it just been a case of just whenever you get that spare second to do a little bit here and there?
When we went to Rome, my husband and I generally go out on our own expense the week before, and we do a lot of sightseeing and travel before the match. So took my brand new trekking boots with the intention of breaking them in, because the advice is that's utterly essential. So took them, we walked up Vesuvius, we walked probably about 10 miles each day in various archaeological sites and things like that, and touch wood, no problems with the boots so far. Right. So that's about the extent of the input so far.
Hey, every little helps, so yeah, every absolutely. Little helps. You've done more than me in the past month.
I was going to say that. Busy day yesterday as well. Obviously, the win against against France, it was a brilliant day all round. Really, the element of control and the performance and the victory. But from your point of view, how proud were you of the performance and the, I suppose, the event that we managed to create yesterday?
I have to say, the events at Murrayfield are always fantastic anyway. The events team just pull everything out of the hat. The weather certainly helped. A lot of travelling support from France in some absolutely outstanding costumes. So that was fun to see.
What was your favourite? Any notable ones?
I think Asterix the Gaul.
Yeah, I saw that one as well. It was very good. And there was the Power Rangers as well, which I thought was quite good. But yeah.
So it's great seeing all the travelling supporters arrive. The match itself was outstanding. Outstanding. I thought the defence was so robust, it was unbelievable. The discipline was good in most of the game. The red card certainly helped us in our game. And all round, it was a big day for me, I suppose, because it's my last home Six Nations match. So obviously I was tasked to do various things, like take the match ball out onto the pitch. Had to do an interview at half time, which I'm not always comfortable with, as you know. And the atmosphere was great, and I think the spectacle was fantastic. It was good.
The victory helps, doesn't it? And delivering that under the challenges it's been the last say a month or so, 3 or 4 weeks, it was a pretty a fulfilling day on and off the field, and we'll look ahead to next week.
Now, Dee, unfortunately, as we know, the Six Nations have announced that the women's Six Nations fixture against Wales has been postponed. Just want to get your take on that, because it's obviously very frustrating that Scotland women can't get any momentum in this tournament.
I don't think I've ever experienced such a turbulent Six Nations for Scotland women, and it's a shame when they're developing at such a great rate with the current input of high-level coaching staff and S&C and everything that we've now put into the team. The one player who has been infected, we wish her well, but I know that she's in the peak of physical fitness and she's receiving the best medical care. The difficulty with Scotland women is that most of them are amateurs, so it's not just simply a case of rescheduling a match which is amenable to Six Nations. These girls have got to take time off work, all sorts of practical issues that they have to take into account that the guys don't.
Yeah, I just want to go back a little bit to something you mentioned earlier on around you being your last home Six Nations. Looking back at your tenure, what sticks out for you?
That's a big question, because the experiences that I've had and the people that I've met have been absolutely astounding. I think Six Nations wise, probably the England-Scotland match last year at Twickenham, because nobody foresaw the second half that we experienced, and that will always be etched in my mind. I've travelled extensively, and that's been an enormous privilege for me as well. One of the best trips, I think, is when we went to Georgia. We met up with some fantastic people, some schoolboys who put on a display match, so we got stuck in with them, and that was good fun. We also somehow managed to inveigle our way onto the set of The Fast and the Furious.
That's right, yeah.
And it turned out the director actually was one of my neighbours from the northwest of Scotland.
Yep, that's true.
So there was that. On a domestic level, I think one of the highlights would be the summer road show we did to Orkney and Shetland. that was great, and it helped us to understand the challenges that are faced by the rural clubs, albeit I'm from a rural club myself, but when you add on, you know, a ferry crossing of several hours or flights that they have to take to get to training or to get to matches, it's certainly a very humbling experience, and we hope to undertake more roadshows to go to more rural clubs and understand them a bit better.
Yeah, and you mentioned that England match, that famous draw. It was probably a little bit extra memory for you, the fact that Magnus got on the score sheet that day. So what was it like when you just saw Magnus skipping through and taking that ball?
Well, it was fantastic, because my eyesight's so bad I couldn't actually see it was him, but from the running style I thought, that does look like my son. And then when he takes the wee pass from Ali Price, and if you notice, that's when Darcy goes down. But I just have to ask myself, you know, that pass was ultimately destined for Darcy. To run onto. He went down. Did he fall or was he pushed?
Who knows? Who knows?
But it was fantastic. And the Princess Royal was delighted and gave me a big hug as well. So I don't think wouldn't have had that experience. No.
Well, Dee, we wish you all the best for your epic adventure at the end of the month. If you want any more information around this, just head to justgiving.com/fundraising/Dee Bradbury. Dee, all the best. We'll get you back on after it so you can give us a big debrief, but I'm sure you'll be fine, and best of luck.
Thank you for your well wishes, but also the generosity of the people that have contributed towards that Just Giving page so far has been astounding. Obviously, we want to maximise the amount of money that we can raise for the foundation, so please dig deep and do your best.
Brilliant. Thanks, Dee.
Thank you.
Don't forget, the application window for the Royal Bank Rugby Force is now open. To be in with a chance to win practical and financial support to kickstart your club season, search Royal Bank Rugby Force. Mossy, brilliant to hear there from Dee Bradbury, Scottish Rugby's president. She talked about the game a little bit. She mentioned the red card in her kind of overview of the game. I just want to talk to you about that red card, because you were obviously on commentary, and I think when it all kicked off, I heard you say, "Oh, something's happening off the ball." So you obviously seen it straight away, didn't you?
It was a penalty advantage, wasn't it? And I just, you know, when you catch something off your eyes, actually, initially I thought there was two different kind of skirmishes, but it was just where the play had been, and then where the players were going to, so it was kind of separate. I think that then contributed to the fact that players were running in from quite a long way.
Yep.
And it was a red card, absolutely no doubt whatsoever. I think Jamie Ritchie is quite lucky that although it was a punch, it was a glancing blow, because it was some force, and I think we're all quite thankful it wasn't any further back towards his jaw. Completely, you know, just a rash action by a young prop who needs to hold his discipline better.
I've always said this, at some point in the Six Nations, France seemed to go through this phase of just maybe reckless abandonment. They just seem to just kind of not fall apart, but there's always a bit of a change, is there not? Is it just their emotion?
It's part of what makes them good in some ways, but it's also part of the problem when they lose their discipline. They're a very emotional side, they're an emotional nation, and that emotion channeled in the right way is very difficult to deal with, very difficult to play against. But when it steps over the mark and it becomes uncontrolled, then ultimately, you know, history shows that it can cause them problems. But channeling it is really important, and I think the game against Scotland from a French point of view will actually be an important learning curve as they build towards the World Cup that's in France in 2023, because it will be moments like that they can, if they're as young as the group are, that'll be roughly the group that I believe will take them forward to the World Cup, and they'll be able to point back to moments like that that did cost them out in the game, although I thought Scotland were comfortable at 15 versus 15 anyway. I thought the control was excellent, but that's a moment, if you're thinking about learning and working together and learning from it as a squad, that they can point to with a proper consequence of saying, listen, if you lose your discipline, yeah, we play on the edge, yeah, you need the drive and the passion, but let's not be silly, because it ultimately costs you.
I saw it coming when the French got off the bus yesterday.
He said Murrayfield, this.
The captain, another, I can't remember who the other player was, but they started walking towards the tunnel, and their coach just went mental at them and like literally grabbed them and pulled them back. And it was like, they almost started scrapping the side of the bus. I thought, that's just such a French thing to do. But
you think they were arguing over the tunes in the bus, do you think?
Or? I don't know, but there was... I knew then we were going to win.
It is a fine balance. I've been in the changing room after the game where French players have been fairly physical towards each other as well. I remember going and swapping jerseys with somebody and a fight broke out after the game
between two
French players. Yeah. And usually in a rugby surroundings, you know, people would be diffused in some way from them. Nobody bothered, they just let them fight in the corner. So I quickly got the shirt swapped out of there.
Did they not used to be like when they used to line up together? They would come out, the French, and they would have been in the changing room and they would have just been knocking lumps at each other, so they'd get them. That was a motivational cue.
Certainly forwards. A long time ago now, certainly not really part of the professional era. The other thing as well that a lot of people don't understand in terms of as an international player, when you leave the changing room, you've almost sometimes 10, 12 minutes before you actually start playing. You know, with anthems and presentations, and it can be a long time. So actually controlling your emotion at the point you leave the dressing room, for every, you know, most club players and most games you play, you come out, you're straight into it. So there is a heightened emotion needed there. But actually, in an international, you have to temper it and wait that 8, 10, 12 minutes, whatever it is, and then get that peak again for the kickoff.
Well, we don't see red cards very often, and that's actually only the fifth red card that there's ever been here at BT Murrayfield. And that's from 1967 was the first.
Is that right?
Until 2020, obviously, at the weekend there. So yeah, only ever been five, and
never been
a Scotland player sent off at Murrayfield. So interesting wee stat for you there. And after the match with France, we heard from Scotland captain Stuart Hogg and head coach Gregor Townsend.
Yeah, chuffed a bit for that. You know, we worked incredibly hard all week to take ourselves every opportunity to win them. And we managed to back up our training performances and really take it to France. Incredibly proud of the boys' efforts, and we're very happy with that. Yeah, you get a feel for momentum in the game, and you know, I felt at the time we were on top, and we discussed it as leaders of, you know, what we were going to do. We back ourselves, and then you know we get the outcomes that we're looking for. And you know, just after the red card as well, we thought about going to the corner, and the more we discussed it and got a feel for what the coach would like as well, we decided to take the three and get back down there just before half time. So you know, we've got a good group of leaders that work incredibly closely together. So we trust our decision making. You know, we talked a lot before the game of you know, great memories are made by great opportunities, and today was a great opportunity for us to achieve something special as a 23 and as a country, and I believe we've done that.
Sometimes a red card can really help you, but I felt France coped with the one man down in terms of how they worked in the set piece, and also gave them a bit of a kickstart of having to play more rugby to try and win, and they're a very dangerous team when they're offloading, putting little chip kicks in, counter-attacking. So who knows? Obviously, if you have one-man advantage, it's better than having the same numbers in the field. But I felt we played really well when it was 15 against 15. And the weather was more of a factor than probably the red card in those last 20 minutes. Yeah, look, I've been really encouraged right throughout the campaign. I felt the 2 weeks of training we had before the Ireland game was shown in the Ireland game, and how we played and how physical we were, how we were able to play at a real pace and creating opportunities that day. Yeah, we didn't win, and we probably had left a couple of tries out there, but we've been consistent throughout. And even the England game, I was so proud of how we came back in that second half. Well, we're only 3 points behind, but it felt 20 points given that we're playing into the wind. And a 3-3 with, I think, 15 minutes to go, and what I believe was a clear penalty for Adam to go six, for knock over and go 6-3 up. That's shown that we have been in the fight in those two games, the two defeats. And obviously the last two wins showed the mentality and the confidence of the group to get out and find a way to win. But there's more to come. More to come from us defensively, even though we're doing that area well. You get confidence when you see the rewards you get for doing something. And the way we're training really gives me a lot of encouragement. Like, we had a big session on Wednesday, a lot of physicality, a lot of tackling, a lot of contact work, and we saw the players take that into the performance today.
Now, that wasn't the only rugby from the weekend. We had the under-20s at Netherdale on Friday night, and we also had some Fosrock Super 6 action that was rescheduled. Let's go first to the under-20s at Netherdale. Mossy, I believe you were down there watching the game.
Saw the game, yeah. It was a loss for the under-20s, 22 points to 29. France are traditionally very strong under-20 level, and they have won the World Championship, as we know, with the players that we see in the national team now over the last 3 or 4 years, 2 or 3 years. And although it was a frustrating defeat for our lads, there was a level of competitive edge that there probably hasn't been in you know, a number of years. Physically, it was excellent. Scored another couple of good tries. The certainly the first try that France scored came from two wonderful offloads, and it was well scored. But Scotland would want to defend it better. So there was definitely a competitive edge to it. The French bench made a difference. They came on, you know, second half, and then really didn't change the game, but gave an element of power and control that Scotland really couldn't quite cope with. Some good individual performances, and they'll travel to Wales this weekend, our under-20s, to take on Wales, who got the first win of the under-20s championship, beating England 23 points to 22 in England. So Scottish lads will learn from last week. They have to keep that level of physicality and level of combative nature, and just try and be a little bit more accurate in order to beat Wales. That was Wales' first win, so both sides are levelling points, 8 points each in the championship table. Wales are just ahead in fourth place in points difference, but the challenge is to go down to Colwyn Bay and get that second win in the championship.
Any players stand out for you on both sides?
Yeah, as always, I think that the under-20s this year have really, really delivered up front. Their scrum has been exceptional. Lambert, Prop and Wilson and Ewan Ashman at hooker kind of led that from the front row, and Cammy Henderson in the second row. The scrum and the physicality up front's been excellent. Ollie Smith at fullback had another dangerous game. There's some good players. The French fullback was a class apart, in all honesty. I can't remember his name. And the right winger scored a decent try. There's one or two players who I thought our players were ahead of them. Like, if you got a head to head positional, it wouldn't, you know, I think we were ahead in maybe, you know, more positions than certain of recent years. Jordan Joseph, the number 8 that for France, a lot of people may remember, he's played the last two or three seasons for the French under-20s. He plays for Racing Metro in the top 14. He's played in Europe, but he was nullified. He scored the first try. You know, he galloped in from 20 yards off an offload, but around the breakdown and around the field, he was nullified. By our excellent back row again, Darge and Boyle, and the names that we like to watch coming through.
So a 29-22 defeat for the Scotland under-20s boys down at Gala. But there's still more action in the Fosrock Super 6, and we're kind of getting a clearer picture now of how the playoffs are going to look, aren't we, Mossy?
Yeah, the playoffs decided. The final game was the postponed fixture that was rearranged for Friday night. Watsonians winning at home by a single point to Southern Knights, 27-26. Watsonians had to come right back at the death and stop the Knights' win and run, and that'll actually be the first semi-final as well. Watsonians will play Knights, and Heriots will play Ayrshire Bulls. With Stirling and Barrowmuir playing in the playoffs between 5th and 6th. So the winners of Watsonians and Knights will play the winners of Heriots and Bulls in the final at Scots, and then we have got a clearer picture. These games are the weekend of the 20th of March, the semi-finals, so not too long to see for the players to really get their head around knockout rugby. A lot of the early fixtures that we spoke about before, there was kind of rotation and selection, but come knockout rugby, it's obviously the strongest team I believe you can get in the field and figure out a way to win. So we'll look forward to those, and then obviously the final the week later.
Fosrock Super 6 final will take place on Saturday the 28th of March. Tickets are on sale now. Simply visit scottishrugby.org for more info. And finally, Old Glory DC continued their winning streak over in the MLR with a 31-29 victory over Rugby Atlanta, and their next fixture is against the Colorado Raptors.
Another thing happening in Scottish rugby at the moment is just that the Fosrock Super 6 was finalised, or the playoffs were finalised last weekend, with Watsonians and Knights playing at the final fixture. Watsonians just squeezing through at the end, having to come from behind really late on against Southern Knights, but they came through on top by a point, and they topped the Fosrock Super 6 table. And then that obviously means that Watsonians will play Southern Knights in a rematch in the first semi-final. That's Saturday 21st of March at 4 p.m. At Myerside, and in the second semi-finals, Heriots taking on Ayrshire Bulls at Golden Acre on Sunday at 2 o'clock, Sunday 22nd of March at 2 o'clock, and that will be broadcast live on Scottish Rugby TV. The following week, the final, as we know, is at Scotson, so we look forward to seeing how the Fosrock Super 6 settles out.
We're joined by Scotland defence coach Steve Tandy. Steve, how are you?
Yeah, very good. Yeah, not too bad. Just got a bit of training done. So, yeah, the boys are in pretty good place. So, yeah, I know where you're going with it. You going with my leg? Is that where you're going?
Oh,
you
I wasn't going to, but you've mentioned it. Yeah. Now, so you better tell us what you've done to yourself.
Yeah, just ruptured my Achilles a little bit. Trying to be a bit of a player last week. Just doing a little bit of defence with the boys, pretty minor, and then ended up rupturing my Achilles.
Athlete's injury, they call it.
Definitely athletes. Fast twitch.
The doc spending more time with you than he is with the players these days, or?
No, I'm trying not to. The boys make enough fun of me as it is. Trying to keep clear of the docs.
Well, before we have a bit of a deep dive into the Scotland job and what you've been doing in the last few weeks, the first time that myself, Mossy, and you would have been together, you'd have been playing for the Ospreys. So we probably took the park against them when we were both playing at Edinburgh.
Often, really. I remember Steve playing the back row and probably running about after. So Ospreys were particularly strong then as well, and you were a key, crucial part of that Ospreys side and successful as well. Won a few championships.
Yeah, we won three when I was a player, and obviously there's loads of competition. We had some awesome overseas players.
Matty Holler, Tia Tia.
Marshy come in.
We
had Stephen DeBlanche, and then we had a real group of local kids that all sort of grew up and played for Neath and Swansea together, and then that combined, I think it was in 2003, and that was the basis of what we were, and it was just an awesome experience.
Were you a Neath before that?
I played a Neath. Me, Adam, Duncan, and those boys all come through Neath together. And
the
then
first iteration of the tight fitting jerseys.
Oh my God, that was
remember
not good.
Ones?
That was a good look for any of us. That was not a good look for any of us.
I hated playing against Ospreys, and predominantly because you mentioned it, Mossy, very good team at the time, but also the strength of the team during the Six Nations, during the Autumn Test, when the Welsh boys went away, where you had Marty Holler at seven, Jerry Collins and Tia Tia in the back row. And if you needed a second row, you'd shove Tia Tia up, and you've got, I almost said Jughead, Ryan Jones in the back row, and all these, I suppose, younger lads, Ian Evans.
Yeah, we had like Sir Linda Bateman, and a lot of us, probably when the boys went to national rugby, like you said, we got a lot of game time at the point then, and we had some awesome foreigners who passed on a lot of knowledge, and it was great learning for us as players, which was pleasing.
And did you know at that point, or did you assume at that point, you wanted to coach, or were you preparing to be a coach?
No, I weren't planning to be a coach. I loved sort of working with the boys that were coming through, the academy guys that had probably gone into teaching or something to do with coaching probably, but I didn't have my mindset of being a pro coach or anything. It was just probably helping people.
But you progressed into that pretty quickly, didn't you? Just almost as soon as you finished playing, you got involved with an assistant coach initially, was then head coach pretty quickly.
Yeah, so Horry was there, and I was in my last 1 year, and there was a coaching opportunity in Bridgend, and he was keen to put me on my coaching badges and things, and it was something I was like, I'll do it sort of later. But my missus gave me a bit of a kick and said, you need to start preparing for after rugby, and then I went to coach Bridgend for a season, which was amazing. Really enjoyed that, and then done a little bit of work with the first team and around the breakdown, and Scott Johnson was a big influence in around helping my development. And then sort of half a year later, I ended up getting the Osprey head job.
You catch up with John over the weekend? I know he was back over for a game. Were you chatting to him afterwards?
Yeah, I had breakfast with Jono on what day was it? Yeah, Monday. Yeah, we had breakfast with Jono, so he doesn't change, in fairness.
He doesn't change, no.
He's quick with his tongue, and he's keen to poke fun, and obviously he'd done his Achilles before, but he didn't stop walking. He didn't need crutches. He didn't need a boot or anything. He just took him an hour, a bit of rest on the bed, and he was as good as new.
Fast forwarding through the Ospreys years, a wee bit of time over in Australia, and then you get the call, an opportunity to come up to work with Gregor as defensive coach, one that you grabbed by both hands.
Oh yeah, it was I was loving life in Australia, to be honest with my family. We uprooted the kids and went to Australia, which was an amazing experience for us. The Waratahs were unbelievable. The welcome we had as for me as a coach, the players were amazing to work with. It definitely opened my eyes in around the coaching, lots of learning. Felt very uncomfortable, not in the sense of people making me feel uncomfortable, as me as a coach that going into Super Rugby and coaching some great players, being a Welsh kid. It was pretty special. The climate, the competition was amazing. And I was planning to probably do another 2 or 3 years in Australia. And then I had a call from Gregor, and then just, yeah, that turned my head straight away. And the Waratahs are amazing. They were really sort of pleased for me to get an international experience. But the minute Gregor rang, I'd watched a lot of the World Cup and just in around the demo, the age of the group, and see a lot of the players. And then you start watching more after Gregor rang, and realisation of what a special group it could be.
And you obviously, well, you know a lot of the players, I've maybe played against a lot of them and coached against a lot of them, you know, in recent times. But the kind of initial thing was, this is going to be a really difficult job, because if you don't have a lot of time leading into a Six Nations, you only got two or three weeks really, but the impact has been incredible so far. So what was the kind of first challenge that you felt? Was it the time element, or was it the fact that you maybe don't want to change too much, you want to fine-tune little details? What was the kind of biggest challenge that you felt leading into the Six Nations?
Yeah, I think obviously you look at Scotland and there's some really good defenders in the team anyway, and there's a lot of principles already embedded in what Scotland were. There were a couple of key principles that I wanted to change, but the realisation, and I think being in Super Rugby taught me that you don't get a lot of time. We had the Australian players for a couple of weeks before they come back in, so rather than moaning about the time you haven't got, it's more about, well, we've got elements of time, and it's just changing a couple of key principles and trying to make it as simple as possible for the boys.
And defensive coaches I've worked with and over the years, you get a balance between the emotional, heart in the sleeves, right, boys, you know, do this for the jersey, and then the ones who are really, really technical and everything in between. Where do you lie? Where's your fit as far as you trying to get your messages across to the players?
Yeah, I'd like to think I'm a little bit of both. I love being able to represent Scotland, and I love working hands-on with the players. I think there's an emotional side to it, but I do love the technical. I do love picking up the individuals, going through one-on-one things. But I think what mainly underpins defence is the physicality and that buy-in, and that's something I think you can add the principles around it, and that's where I think the Scottish boys have got. They've got big hearts, they've got real courage, and just making sure that we can use that passion and that physicality to implement our D.
Fantastic. And how are the boys taking to the accent? I heard you the other day when you were training, I think it was out at Ravenscraig, shouting Boyle. That was all right as well. I thought that was quite good, wasn't it?
Wasn't bad.
It was average. It was a couple of double takes. Mike Blair's along the lines of you, making fun pretty much every hour. But the boys, there's a lot of double takes, and sometimes when I do get a little bit more passionate and start speaking a little bit faster, they've got to maybe speak again or a little bit slower, because Mike reckons I roll at least six words into one.
And looking at a game just gone by, they get a Six Nations over the last few weeks. You must be delighted with the impact you've managed to make in a short time.
Yeah, I think I'm extremely proud of the players, and I feel really lucky to be part of an amazing environment. And I know that's probably, like, people think probably it's easy to say you just come in, but the environment from day one has been really pleasing to be part of. The coaching dynamic, really love coming to work. There's different characters, but the players, the welcome and also the buy-in has been awesome, and just really pleased the players, really proud of them, and how they went after France. And France are a big physical team. At the end of the day, they were on for the Grand Slam, and just really proud of the players' efforts and what they put in on the weekend, and for the other three games too.
Right, I think it was underlined at the weekend, really, but France get their momentum. Well, they get their game built from the momentum from the big front five or Caris, but they just didn't get that. We've seen, you know, Dupont and Intermac almost not stroll through games, but be able to, you know, apply how wonderful players they are because of that momentum. It didn't, and that starts with the defence. And, you know, a lot of the boys have quite rightly given you a lot of credit in the way that you've set them up, but the way you've kind of just really got them to buy into that physical element. Would you say that the tackle height has increased a little bit in order to slow the possession down, or is it just more physicality?
Yeah, I think sometimes you get caught up in seeing the height. I think it's just operating. We're trying to make more double tackles, and then the decision with the first guy, we obviously won to take the legs away, but then the second guy's got a license to operate at a different level and go after the ball in different ways. You've got, like, you look at Adam Hastings and these boys, they're spending time in the tackle, they're working on the ball.
Bigger players up as well, aren't they? They're really impressed at the weekend.
That's really impressed me with the boys. And when we say about a defence, it's not about just the back row or the front five or whatever, it's about 1 to 15 and this bench coming on. I think that's what a defensive system is, everyone buying in and everyone giving everything they got. Doesn't matter if it's the smallest man in the field. You look early in the game, Ali and Adam, I think it's on Vak Tower, they spend 11 seconds in the tackle, which gives us a little bit of room to move and get off the line. It does set tones. Obviously, we're not rocking people back all the time, but yeah, it's just a really good mindset from the group and fans.
And looking ahead then to this weekend, you know the Welsh group of players probably very well. You've played with a couple of them as well, yeah. I would imagine. So you'll be able to bring that knowledge, but does it add to it a wee bit as well for you that it is against Wales, or are you treating it as any other game?
Yeah, I think other people make it bigger than what it is. For me, I'm representing Scotland, and the only thing I can think about is winning in Cardiff. It'd be an awesome moment for the players first and foremost, and that's what I'm trying to do is make our players as good as they can be, and I'll be enjoying it. It'd be a unique experience for me going up to players I coached against, who we've got a lot of time for. Some of them are really good friends, the likes of Alan Wynn, like Biggs, Tiprick, they're great humans, and you've worked them a long time. But it's definitely something we would love to go down to Cardiff and win and share a beer after the game.
And a bit of banter from the boys as well. Are you sending Alan Wynn pictures of you with a thistle on?
No. I think we haven't spoken over the Six Nations because that moment will probably come. But no, look, it's just you've got so much respect from his players, and I think it's just everyone will be focusing on themselves, and I'm sure there'll be a couple of handshakes before the game and things. Yeah, it's going to be a unique experience. Probably I'll get more of a ribbon from my mates, and they're all support. There's a lot of Scotland flags, I think, in Tomahon, my local village, but I don't know whether I'll have them. They'll be out on the weekend going to Wales. But the kids will be down there. They'll be in their Scotland jerseys, and we'll be hoping for a win. And like obviously watching Wales as a kid growing up has been amazing, but to represent Scotland at this moment in time has been an unbelievable experience for me and my family.
Brilliant. Well, Steve, thank you very much for your time in a test week. Best luck this weekend, and also best luck with that recovery for that ankle. Hope Mike Blair looks after you well.
Yeah, he's doing absolutely nothing to help me with my recovery, in fairness.
He's not even carrying your bags, is
No,
he?
No, he doesn't. He jumps straight in the car. He's stole all my crutches. No, yeah,
he's a dreadful, selfish. He's a dreadful
selfish.
Man, isn't he?
Selfish.
Well, absolutely Steve, thank selfish. You.
Well, Al, that was Steve Tandy, you say, Scotland's new defence coach, and you can see the influence he's made and contributed to on the field, but you can also see how warm a person, how easy he is to fit into the system, and how well-respected and well-liked he is by the players. He's a likeable man with some good principles and a hard edge as well, isn't he?
It's a slightly loaded question that I gave him around what type of coach he was, because from what I hear from the players, he gets that balance spot on. You know, it's at times about making sure emotionally you can get yourself in the right place for defence, but the technical part is so, so important. And he probably knows, or has learnt quickly, which buttons to press and which players.
I think he knows as well his experience is fairly recently as a player, and then going straight into being, almost in the deep end as a head coach with a professional team in the Ospreys, a lot of pressure, winning the championship, and then test himself in Super Rugby. You can tell that the players have a huge amount of respect because he knows what he's talking about, and he's lived what he's talking about, and he'll, as you say, he'll know how to best get that over. So it's been built on a lot of good work done the years before, but he's really doing well with the squad, and hopefully that'll continue. I'm sure it will this weekend.
Yeah, and we saw it last weekend. You touched on it, the fact that you
stop the French physicality.
Exactly. You stop the physicality, you stop the momentum. Mm-hmm. And at times, for me, they looked a bit lost as far as how they were going to attack. They started playing a lot more off 10, which didn't suit them, because if anything, they were sitting too deep. But that, I believe, was all because plan A wasn't there for them.
Well, that's the thing. It's the French front five in the first three games were brilliant, in attack and defence. Massive men winning the gain line, getting in behind, allowing the backs to play in the front foot, but that was just stopped dead in the tracks at the weekend. And it's an easy thing to identify. I'm sure the other three teams that played already identified that, but couldn't do it. The difficulty is actually doing it and executing it and stopping these players. Now, even when it was 15-15, I still think Scotland were in total control of that game, whether it was with the ball or without the ball, whether the ball was in play or out of play. And I'd say that was built off the back of the physicality and defence.
Referee get the decisions right? Two big moments, one right at the beginning of the game and then one just at half time.
I made comment in the commentary about the role of Valemsa coming in the second player in on the tip tackle on Gilko. But I think the tip was already taking place before he kind of added his weight.
There was no lift, there was a kind of push really.
I think what the way I summed up in commentary was that almost Francois Cross was almost trying to make a dominant tackle from a fairly passive position. The initial contact was fine, he wrapped his arm, but he's on his knees and he's then trying to drive Gilko back as Gilko's trying to place the ball. So
pushes him up rather than back,
yeah,
because of the kind of passive position he's on his knees. And I think a red card would have been quite difficult. I mean, it looks like a red card. I understand it looks bad. But I think part of the red card is driving the player into the ground, and he certainly didn't drive him.
No.
I think I would say he probably got it about right.
Yeah, I thought the first one was right. The points you've made there, there was no left turn and press down. Mm. It was a direct hit, and just with the way the direct hit happened, Gilco landed poorly.
With a second player coming in as well.
You wouldn't have been overly surprised if he'd pulled out a red.
No.
I was sitting, it was Big Doddy next to me saying that he thought it was just a penalty at the time. Yeah, then yeah, you look back on it probably the yellow card was a good balance.
Initially, didn't he? And then kind of came to the right decision, I believe, through the decent process of asking his assistant referees and TMO and likely the red card later on. The initial thing was, listen, I don't know what's happened. It doesn't look like that much. And then through, you know, just taking a step back, taking a deep breath, looking at it, you know, calmly, the punch appeared. So I think got both decisions spot on.
Ah, the red, I mean, that punch at that stage, there's, as you see it landing, there's a few stills floating around of it as well. Jamie Ritchie is a guy, I love the way he plays the game. He's technically brilliant in and around that breakdown, doing all the work that he can possibly do. But he also pushes people's buttons, and he pushes people's buttons to the point where they react.
I think as well, I think in many ways he was quite lucky that, I know the pictures look bad, but I think the picture looks so bad because it is a glance and he's caught kind of the edge of his nose and the edge of his face. If that's further back, if that's in the jaw, I think we're dealing with a really bad situation. So I think he was lucky enough just to get out of it. He then got clobbered from Gael Fiku as well, so it wasn't the greatest couple of seconds for Jamie, but he pops up to his feet, he holds himself well, and he gets on with it, which is good to see as well. But yeah, definitely red card, something that will help us at this before, probably help France in the long term, in terms of everything has almost gone their way and they've got this opportunity to learn from bad discipline hurting them again ahead of their, I suppose, this team that's really focusing on a World Cup in 2023.
I agree with you completely, Mossy, and also the fact that Scotland looked great 15-on-15. The red card definitely has an effect on the game. I thought what was the best thing about the Scotland performance in the second half was the patience as well, because it's really easy when teams down to 14 to go chasing the space, whereas you've got to actually earn the right to get into that space in the first place. But Scotland did that well.
Just really good all round. Said it again, the control element, not forcing anything, not playing a huge amount of rugby or not taking a huge amount of risks in and around your own half. Probably moved the clearance zone, if that makes sense, from your 22 up to halfway. So there's opportunities, one or two opportunities, I think, or half opportunities to attack from, you know, just outside your own third, but we didn't take them because it's minimising risk. And I think that's almost, you know, a good blueprint for success in international rugby at the moment. Excellent all-round performance, disciplined, hard-working, and just, you know, sets a good platform for this weekend. It's a 6-day turnaround to Wales, which makes it a challenge. It's another away trip. Wales are off the back of another defeat. They pose threat at home. Listen, how many times have Wales found an extra gear in that red jersey at home? It's a threat, but it's one that I think we can really go after this weekend.
So even more dangerous, I believe, because they've not had a great Six Nations. Results-wise, hasn't gone their way. I mean, this will be a game that they see as an absolute must-win for more reasons than just the championship points.
It is, absolutely. The pressure that's on a Welsh player, or any player, but certainly a Welsh player at home in Cardiff after a difficult season so far, only one victory. They're not far away. They're changing the style of play.
Well, the coaching group must feel that pressure as well.
They do. I mean, Stephen Jones was part of it in the World Cup. The assistant coach was a brilliant coach, former number 10. But Wayne Pivac's new to it. And he, you can see where the changes are trying to come from Warren Ball, if that was still a thing, to a more kind of balanced, wider approach, an attacking game that won Pivac the Guinness Pro 14 with the Scarlets. So,
how long does that take? What do you reckon?
Well,
Is that a six-month process?
I think it takes... A lot of it will depend on how well ingrained the previous system was. Now, the previous system and strategies have been ingrained for over 10 years and had a lot of success.
I think a lot of it depends on how many wins you can pick up as well.
That as well,
you try to change a system and you're not picking up the occasional win, Now, not just the fans will be first to go. The fans will be like, well, we don't care what type of rugby we're playing, just get us winning. But as the players will be more bought into it. But if the players don't start winning games or certainly see progress, then they'll switch off to it.
Maybe. I mean, the players will know where the end point is or what the vision and how they're going to get there. But ultimately, international rugby is in the here and now. It's instant. And I think because the processes were so long, and it is a slightly different game to what Warren Gatland played, and a lot of the players are used to that, and under pressure you sometimes revert back to type, or what we know as instinct. Now, instinct is learned behaviour, but it just becomes instinct because you've done it so often, and you go to that movement, to that action. The way that Scarlets used to play and Wales are trying to play isn't quite instinctive yet for them, so under pressure they might still go back to an old system and there's a bit of confusion. Listen, they're still a brilliant side.
So has that changed? So on that point then, Moshe, do you think they'll change personnel over the next 6 months? They've already chopped and changed a little bit. Toby Faletau on the bench for the first time, I believe, in his international career.
Yeah, he'd been injured as well. And I think it's, you know, he came in, maybe hadn't had his best game, so drops to the bench. And Josh Navidi's a brilliant player as well. There is depth there, and there's a rotational element. The nines are interesting. Gareth Davis dropped right out of the squad for the England game. Thomas Williams started. Reece Webb comes back in. So you've got three nines, all very good, quite similar. And that's sometimes a sign of not having a lot of cohesion if there's, you know, only two of those three can be involved. And it was a different two last week to the week before. And who knows what the two of the three will be this week. So there's variance in there, obviously. But the one thing I'd say about experience of playing against Wales in Wales, experience of supporting Scotland when they play in Wales, I've said it earlier on, the Welsh players and team, when they need to, they find an extra gear with that red jersey on in Cardiff. They found it under previous regimes, and you know the worry is, or the awareness has to be from us that they can find that extra edge. So we have to deliver as well.
We do. I remember going down there 2 years ago as a spectator, and probably optimism was as high as it had been from a Scotland point of view, and Wales were brilliant that day. Pratchell played at 10, everybody was talking about being a weak link, and he had a phenomenal game. So, you know, Scotland need to go down there and beat their very best. I'll quietly say that if Scotland can go down there and deliver a performance that we've seen them building towards in this championship, I would like to think we could be in a good place.
Well, Scotland are consistent. You know, you can say that over all the games this year. Yeah, we lost the first two. The inconsistency in Ireland came from just that final 5 metres attack, really, but they were creating opportunities they just didn't quite take. The English game's a bit of an anomaly with the weather and the storm, and it was almost a one-off. And there's been consistency in the set-piece performance, been consistency in the physicality that's been brought in all the games, a consistency certainly in the last two games of staying in the fight, not being easy to play against, and that'll continue. That's ingrained now, I believe, after four games, and we just need to have that extra quality and play away from home with the confidence that what we're doing to get the consistent moment is good, but actually realise the threat that Wales pose in terms of their ability to get up for the big game, but also the level of quality they have, you know, spread out across the players. Some of them will be injured as well. It was a brutal game at Twickenham for them last week. You know, you see Jake Ball going off, it looked like a nasty injury.
Yep. Old pal and Wynn Jones is he had a couple of bangs at you, banging ahead.
Darren Bigger was obviously going into that with
ugly incident with Joe Marlowe as well, which I think he got through, but hopefully he'll be okay.
Yeah, it was a strange one, wasn't it?
It was
very
incredible.
Strange one, that. Yeah.
But I think we'll leave that one well alone. Before we move on, I'll say our goodbyes. It's worth definitely having a look back at Kyle Steyn and Fraser Brown and a bit on them. You know Kyle well, you worked with him at Glasgow as well.
Yeah, I was delighted for him. He's such a quality player. Like everything, for me, everything he does is quality. He's big, he's physical, he kicks well, he runs well, he's good in the air, he tackles well, he's played 13, he's played in the wing, he makes an impact in games, and I thought I was so delighted to see him coming on and then getting up winning a high ball.
He had a good impact, didn't he?
He did make a great impact, and he's a really hard working, honest soul with a great attitude. So, as always, it's a delight to see players getting their first cap, but Kyle definitely, he looked like he belonged in that environment.
Yeah, and Fraser Brown, a fantastic character, a guy
He plays a good lad, isn't
he plays a game the tough way as well. Oh, he's grumpy. The boys call him the negator. But he just plays a game. He's the type of guy when you're walking on the park you want next to you. So, okay, I've played a few games alongside him. He definitely calls a spade off the park, but that's a big moment for him leading the team on for his 50th.
Yeah, no, absolutely. And with Fraser, you know, everybody talks about rugby and how important the team dynamic is in rugby. Every team, every squad needs a Fraser Brown in terms of he's just brilliant for, as you say, calling a spade, saying the right thing at the right time, following through with action, setting an example in his physicality and his desire, not getting caught up in the hype of being too high or too low. Just really, just a brilliant example of what a professional is, and the level of physicality that he brings, and the injury that he suffered earlier on in his career, it's brilliant to see him reach 50 caps and go on to get more.
Yeah, and he's got a brilliant rivalry going at the moment with Stuart McInally. They push each other incredibly hard. They make each other better players. And I was speaking to Stuart after the squad had been announced, and just the way he reacts. I think shows the quality of the men as well. So, you know, long may that continue.
Another thing happening in Scottish rugby at the moment is just the Fosbrook Super Six was finalised, or the playoffs were finalised last weekend, with Watsonians and Knights playing at the final fixture. Watsonians just squeezing through at the end, having to come from behind really late on against Southern Knights, but they came through on top by a point, and they topped the Fosbrook Super Six table. And then that obviously it means that Watsonians will play Southern Knights in a rematch in the first semi-final. That's Saturday, 21st of March at 4 p.m. At Myreside. And in the second semi-finals, Heriot's taking on Ayrshire Bulls at Golden Acre on Sunday at 2 o'clock, Sunday 22nd of March at 2 o'clock. And that will be broadcast live on Scottish Rugby TV. The following week, the final, as we know, is at Scotson. So we look forward to seeing how the Fosbrook Super Six settles out.
We should say, sitting in the reception, the background music. And the background music isn't the fact that Chris has left his Walkman on in his pocket. So just in case you're picking up a little bit of noise. I deliberately went with Walkman
because I'm old.
Because you're old, right, and I know you don't really enter into this.
I was going to say we're in an elevator, but that's it's not great either.
I mean, people at home might be picturing you right now with the headphones, the foam part just hanging around, no noise cancellation, plugged into the Sony disc cassette.
Oh, it was way before that. My first Walkman, I don't think it was called a Walkman. It was called a personal stereo, and it had a radio.
Oh, fancy.
So that's even before the Walkman that came out just with the cassette recorder. So you could actually tune into
the BBC
shipping forecast.
The mini disc fad?
No.
Yes, yeah, I was. Right in the heart of it.
I was never going to last.
Wasted a bundle of money, had mini discs coming out of my ears, and then...
Have you got any lying about in the garage still?
I think they've gone now. There's still VHSs lying around. I'm not sure what we're going to do with them.
Yeah, first cap on it, like.
Thank you very much for listening to the official Scottish Rugby podcast together with the Royal Bank of Scotland. As always, we'll be back next week with more exclusive content.